Sister Marcia, please stand. Marcia is a very close friend of our family, and she commented and said, Patrick, I have one visitor coming, Beverly. But Beverly brought two other visitors. So we have three visitors here tonight, please. So at this time, we just want to say thank you for coming, and we hope that tonight's message will be a message that will impact you, so that when you come Friday again, you will come fully prepared to stay until Sabbath next week, when we have a day packed for you. Please, thank you all for coming, and may God bless and keep you. All right.
Good evening, everyone. At this time, we're going to have a mini health talk. And my topic is diabetes. And I know many of us may have known somebody or do know someone who have diabetes. So I have a little video that I would play. It's just about 3 minutes long. And that will tell you what diabetes is, how it happens in the body, and then I'll give you some tips about how to prevent it and how to stay away from it totally. So can I have the video, please?
There are two main types of diabetes, type 1 and type 2. They're different conditions, but they're both serious. There are some other rarer types of diabetes too. What all types of diabetes have in common is that they cause people to have too much glucose in their blood. But we all need some glucose. It's what gives us our energy. We get glucose when our bodies break down the carbohydrates that we eat or drink, and that glucose is released into our blood. We also need a hormone called insulin. It's made by our pancreas, and it's insulin that allows the glucose in our blood to enter our cells and fuel our bodies. If you don't have diabetes, your pancreas senses when glucose has entered your bloodstream and releases the right amount of insulin so the glucose can get into your cells. But if you have diabetes, this system doesn't work. When you've got type 1 diabetes, you can't make any insulin at all. If you've got type 2 diabetes, it's a bit different. The insulin you make either can't work effectively or you can't produce enough of it. In both types of diabetes, because glucose can't get into your cells, it begins to build up in your blood. And too much glucose in your blood causes a lot of different problems. To begin with, it leads to diabetes symptoms, like having to wee a lot, being incredibly thirsty, and feeling very tired. You may also lose weight, get infections, like thrush, or suffer from slow healing wounds. Over a long period of time, high glucose levels in your blood can seriously damage your heart, your eyes, your feet, and your kidneys. These are known as the complications of diabetes. But with the right treatment and care, people can live a healthy life. And there's much less risk that someone will experience these complications. If you've got diabetes, you can find lots of information and support about living with it using our website and helpline. As well as campaigning for everyone with diabetes to get the right care, Diabetes UK fund research into all types of diabetes so we can develop new treatments and one day find a cure. You can learn about type 1 and type 2 diabetes and how they're treated in our next videos. There are two main types of diabetes.
Okay, so what we have learned, that there are two main types of diabetes, type 1 and type 2. Type 1 means that you don't produce any insulin, and type 2, there is a malfunction with the insulin that is produced, that it doesn't get into the cells correctly. Now, you know, diabetes in of itself is not a death sentence. Diabetes can be reversed. I remember Pastor Daly, perfect example. Pastor Daly has always told us about that. And Pastor Daly's diabetes totally reversed. And And it has to do with diet, exercise, or as a matter of fact, lifestyle changes in total, right? They say that you can lose weight for most of us, and you can leave it off. They say you can use 5 to 7% of your body weight. And if you lose 5 to 7% of your body, that's a starting point. And that you, with that, you can start to see that your blood sugar levels start decreasing. And then there is diet. You know, we have to look at the amount of calories that we are taking in. It also says that we must take it in smaller portions. When we eat our foods should be in smaller portion. We must drink a lot of water. Exercise, which means not just walking up and down like me in the house, but going outside and walking, you know, making ourselves active. And that helps with reducing our diabetes. They say get at least 30 minutes of physical exercise 5 days a week. If you have not been active, talk with your healthcare professional about some of the best ways that you can become active. And eat healthy foods most of the times. I mean, I don't know about some people, but sometimes you still have that urge for sweet. It's a nagging urge, but there is that urge sometimes for sweet. I must confess that I have a sweet tooth. And it's crazy sometimes. I even hide from Frankie. Confession is good for the soul. But he, on the other hand, he doesn't like that. He doesn't like sugar. He doesn't like salt. So, but I know that if we work on it, I think we would get it right. You understand? And the side effects to not taking care of it could be massive. We could have heart problems, and worst of all, kidney failure. And that leads to dialysis. And I have seen so many people struggle with that. So I would encourage you to be preventative, right? And if perchance they tell you that you have it, lifestyle changes. And I know that with God's help, you will succeed. I have for those people who may not, run off some things about a game plan. It tells you about this very steps that I taught about weight gain, about weight goals, about eating the right foods and stuff. So if you need, I only have like 9, then you can have one. Thank you kindly. And have a pleasant night.
Good night. Aren't we thankful for all the wonderful things God has done in our life throughout this week? Amen. Aren't we thankful for all the things that he has done to put us in the place that we are now? Amen. Don't we feel I don't know what to say to express my gratefulness for the love that he bestowed upon me. But I just want to say I'm worthy of everything that he shows to me. So join us as we sing, "Worthy is the Lamb." Wash me in your cleansing
thank you for the price you
eyes to my heart, Lord. I want to see you.
Power and love as we sing.
stand for our theme song.
Yeah.
reading from Luke 18, verses 35 to 43. I will read in your hearing. And it came to pass that as he was come nigh unto Jericho, a certain blind man sat by the wayside begging. And hearing the multitude pass by, he asked what it meant. And they told him that Jesus of Nazareth passed by. And he cried, saying, Jesus, thou son of David, have mercy on me. And they which went before rebuked him, that he should hold his peace. But he cried so much the more, thou son of David, have mercy on me. And Jesus stood and commanded him to be brought unto him. And when he was come near, he asked him, saying, what wilt thou do that I shall do unto thee? And he said, Lord, that I might receive my sight. And Jesus said unto him, receive thy sight, thy faith has saved thee. And immediately he received his sight, and followed him, glorifying God. And all the people, when they saw it, gave praise unto God. Amen. Please remain standing.
As we approach the throne room of grace, we shall make use of the hymn, Pass Me Not, O Gentle Savior. Pass me not, O gentle Savior. Assist me, please, sisters. Hear my humble cry while on others thou art passing. Do not pass me by. Shall we put our voices together as we sing this very beautiful prayer song? Pass me not, O gentle Savior. Oh, let the people of God sing.
Me not, O gentle Savior, hear my humble cry. What others thou art for, oh, do not pass me,
do not pass me by.
Sure what difficulty you might have faced today. I'm not sure what challenge that you might face tomorrow. Even when you leave here tonight, I'm not sure what you will face. But we can cast all of our cares upon him who knows what is going to happen tomorrow. We can come boldly to the throne of grace knowing that God is there for us. Brothers and sisters, we do not know the future, but we are serving one who knows the future. Bow your heads, close your eyes with me as we intercede. Father and our God, we thank you for your people who are here. We thank you, Heavenly Father, for these series of meetings that has come to interrupt someone. To be sure, God, that they have received an opportunity to give their life to thee. For those of us who are here in the household of faith, oh God, these messages are designed to strengthen us and to keep us on the straight and narrow path. For those who hear today, oh God, and those who are listening from their homes or wherever they are listening, I pray, God, that your anointing will be upon them. I pray, God, that tonight that they will hear something that will point them in the direction of the cross. That they will hear something that they will realize that, as the Bible says, this is the way, and we'll walk the straight and narrow path. We pray for the manservant tonight. You have been with him during the preparations. You have fortified his mind with the truth in the Bible. And we pray, God, that your anointing will be upon him in his delivery. And when tonight's service will have come to an end, we pray, God, that the people of God will say, I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. And let the people of God say,
amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. I just want to say good evening. I said good evening. I thought I was here by myself. You know, we Homanvilles believe that belief and faith is the catalyst for change. All right? You all said it's your program. All right, experience the change. My first song, I think it's not that well known, but I love the message of the song. Father, who created all there is, and we believe the universe and all therein is his. A loving heavenly Father who yearns to save us all, to lift us from the fall. We believe. We believe in Jesus, the Father's only Son, existing uncreated before time had begun, a sacrifice for sin. He died and rose again to ransom sinful man. We believe. We believe in the Spirit who makes believers one. Our hearts are filled with his presence. The Comforter has come. His kingdom unfolds to his plans, unhindered by quarrels of man. His church upheld by his hand. We believe.
crumble, this one remains. Our faith is not subject to seasons of men. To our Father we proclaim. We believe that the Lord will come as he said. The land and the sea will give up their dead. His children will reign with him as their head. And we believe. We
at this time, we will pick up our evening's offering. Praise team, we could sing a song. Can we stand for prayer, please? Eternal Father and God, we are truly thankful for the offerings that we have returned to you. I pray, Lord, that you will bless it and may it go towards the furtherance of your work. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Please be seated.
Tonight, I have the privilege of introducing our speaker. For the past week and a half, we have had dynamic evangelist preacher here. Did you say amen to that? Tonight, we have someone here who is capable, educated, a friend of God, and a friend of man. And he's in the person of Pastor Ferron Francis. I've known him for quite a long time. As a young elder, we went for training at the conference office, conference camp, Victory Lake. He was my teacher there. As a department leader, as we go from church to church, he was my teacher there. So I'm quite familiar with his content. I am quite familiar with the attitude, and I am quite familiar with the love for God. Ladies and gentlemen, both here and online, you're in for a wonderful experience. But before we hear from our preacher tonight, we will have our theme song, our meditation song, and then our theme song will usher in our pastor. God bless you, and you will be blessed tonight. Thank you.
But losing the race. Of God, say amen again. Our determination is not to go back. We thank God tonight that we don't have to go back. What do you say? My brothers and my sisters, for us not to go back, we must understand, as Brother Anton sing, that we must take hold of the grace of God. We thank God for His marvelous grace. We thank God that we can say, like the psalmist tonight, I will lift up mine eyes unto the hills. From whence cometh my help? My help comes from the Lord. The only way we're not going to go back is if we hold on to the hands of God that can protect us and prevent us from going back. I want to thank God tonight that the Word of God is still being preached here at the Cornerstone Church with clarity, with conviction, with power. And that men, women, boys, and girls are hearing the Word of God and are understanding and responding to the Word of God, saying, yes, Lord, I surrender. What do you say? I want to thank God for those who are watching online and those who are in the house. If you're here for the first time tonight, just raise your hand. It's your very first night here. Any first timer? Well, praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. We have two beautiful sisters over there for the first time. We want to thank God for bringing you here, and we pray that as you worship with us here this evening, God's blessing will really be unto you. The scripture reading that was read earlier, I believe it was read earlier, Luke chapter 18, a very familiar passage of scripture. Allow me just to read again in your hearing, just for emphasis. The Bible says, and it came to pass that as he was come nigh unto Jericho, a certain blind man sat by the wayside begging, and hearing the multitude pass by, he asked what it meant. And they told him that Jesus of Nazareth passeth by. I want to talk this evening under the subject, when Jesus passes by. When Jesus passes by. Pray with me now, Father and God. We give you thanks. We give you praise. We thank you, dear God, that you not just sit up there in heaven and look at us down here, but we praise you tonight, dear God, that you are God who is willing to come down and to tabernacle with us. You have been passing by here night after night, week after week, and God, we thank you for stopping by one more time tonight. And so, God, as we look at your words tonight, we ask, oh God, that you will show up in a powerful way. We pray, dear God, that you'll help us not just to be hearers of the word, but help us to be doers. The Bible says that Isaiah said it this way, that the flowers faded, but the word of God will stand forever. We pray, dear God, that you'll help us tonight to stand on your words. In Jesus' precious name, we pray with thanksgiving, and all of God's people say amen and amen. My brothers and my sisters, it is true that Jesus passes by. He passes by any time the Bible says where two or three are gathered together in his name, Jesus passes by. But I want us to be careful tonight, because Jesus can pass by here and we miss him. You see, Jesus doesn't only pass by when the preacher gets up to preach, but Jesus sometimes passes by when a song is being sung. Amen, somebody. When a prayer is being prayed, when the scripture is being read, when a testimony is being shared, Jesus passes by, and you and I have to be careful that we don't allow Jesus to pass by and we miss him. You see, we can come to church night after night and week after week, and we can go to church all our lives, and Jesus can pass by us and we never get a chance to make an encounter with him. You know, the story was told of this woman that was attending church, and she got frustrated with church folks. You know, sometimes church folks are not always nice to each other. And she just thought that there was just too much criticism and backbiting in the church. And she went to her pastor and she said, "Pastor, I'm done with this church. This is the last time I'm coming here. I'm not coming back." Pastor says, "My sister, I'm sorry to hear that. But before you go, just do me one favor." She says, "What is that, Pastor?" He took a glass from a shelf and he poured some water in it. And he filled the glass all the way up to the brim. And he said to the sister, "Since today is your last time here, I want you to walk around the sanctuary with the glass filled with water one time, and do it a second time at the end of the service, and then come back to me." The sister said, "Okay, Pastor, it's the least I can do. After all, it's my last time here." And so she took the glass of water and she walked around the sanctuary one time at the beginning of the service. And then at the service ended, she took the glass again and she walked around and she came to the pastor's study and she said, "Here is the water, Pastor." Pastor says, "Amazing. Not one drop of water fell from the glass, it seems, my sister." She said, "No, Pastor, I was careful. I was so focused on the glass and the water that I didn't see anybody in church today." I'm trying to tell you something. That when you focus on who you need to focus on, you can be in church even with the devil and still have a time with Jesus. You see, it's easy for us to come to church and miss Jesus because we're looking at the wrong places and the wrong people, and Jesus is passing by, but we miss him because our eyes are not fixed on Jesus. Little songwriter says, "Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in his wonderful face, and the things of this world will grow strangely dim." My brothers and my sisters, I'm going to tell you tonight that Jesus is passing by, but keep your eyes on Jesus, not your brother, not your sister, not the preacher. Keep your eyes on Jesus. The Bible says in our scripture reading that it came to pass that as he, Jesus, came near to Jericho, a certain blind man sat by the wayside begging. Now, my brothers and my sisters, it's amazing to me when you look at the scripture, because notice the man was not identified by name, but by his condition. The Bible says a certain blind man sat by the wayside begging. Isn't it amazing that sometimes people will try to define us and identify us by what is wrong with us? I'm sure this brother had a name. Everybody who was born was given a name by their parents, but nobody took the time to find out what his brother's name was. All they knew it was that it was a blind man who sat by the wayside begging. I'm so glad tonight, my sisters and my brothers, that the Bible says Jesus knows us so very well, he even can number the number of years on our heads. I'm so glad tonight when Jesus looks down here at this church and he looks at those watching online, he doesn't just see us as in our broken state that we are a cancer survivor or we have high cholesterol or we have this kind of problem or that kind of problem. Jesus sees us as sons and daughters of the Most High. I'm so glad with my messed up self, with my broken self, Jesus doesn't look at me with my problems. He sees me as a child of God covered by his blood. You and I ought to be thankful tonight that Jesus doesn't just see us as who and what we are, but who and what we are in him covered by the blood. The Bible says a blind man sat by the wayside begging. And the Bible says, and hearing the multitude pass by, he asked what it meant. You got to give this blind man some credit here. The Bible says he was blind, therefore he could not see who was passing by. But in spite of the fact that he had brokenness in one aspect of his life, I'm so glad that God always gives us something that is working. His sight might have been gone, could not see that the grass was green and the sky was blue, could not see the smile on beautiful children's faces, but I praise God tonight, while his sight I was gone, he could hear. Can I tell you something? Can we talk tonight? The fact of the matter tonight is this. All of us have something broken about us. But I'm so glad that in spite of the fact that this man could not see, he used what God blessed him with that was still working. He heard that Jesus was passing by. You tonight may have your own brokenness. It might be a health challenge, but I thank God tonight that even though you may not be in perfect health, thank God you have enough strength to still hear the word of God and can still be a blessing to God's people. You may not have the money that you'd like to have, but I thank God tonight that you got clean clothes on your back, shoe on your feet, and warm blood flowing through your veins. Thank God that we might be broken, but God still blesses us. Bible says that he heard the commotion. And that's how the body works. You know, when one part of the body breaks down, the other part of the body seems to be working harder to compensate for the part of the body that's not working. And so the fact that he could not see, this man did not allow his blindness to cause him to miss out on the blessings that God has in store for him. And too many times, my sisters and my brothers, we allow what is broken about us to keep us from receiving the blessings of God. There are folks who say they're not going to church because they don't have enough clothes to wear, as if church is a fashion show. There are folks who say they're not going to church because the car is not working, as if the bus stopped working and the Ubers are not working. Can I tell you something? My brothers and my sisters, we shouldn't allow anything to keep us from being with Jesus. We have been living our lives filled with excuses. And brothers and sisters, God sometimes allows us to be broken, not because he can fix us, but because he wants us to learn to depend on him and that he can still use even broken vessels. There is not one perfect here this evening, but I thank God that God can still use broken people to bless broken people. Bible says that he heard the commotion, the multitude passing by, and he asked what it meant. And the Bible says, somebody said to him that Jesus of Nazareth passed by. Now, my brothers and my sisters, please understand that the disciple asked the question. I believe it was Nathanael. Can any good thing come out of Nazareth? In other words, Nazareth was not the place you want to be told, you want someone to say that you're from. That's the hood. That's the ghetto. That's where the worst of the worst comes from. The Bible says, they said, Jesus of Nazareth passes by. But please understand, read your Bibles carefully, because the Bible says, while they said that Jesus of Nazareth passed by, the blind man knew that Jesus was not just from Nazareth, but Jesus was the Messiah sent from God. I'm trying to tell you something here this evening. You see, sometimes we put God in a box. And we believe sometimes that God is only for the poor. Our God is only for the blacks. Our God is only for the whites. Our God is only for those who are affluent. Can I tell you something? Our Jesus that we serve is a Jesus, is a God for everybody. The blind man recognized that Jesus was not just from Nazareth, but Jesus was the Messiah sent from God, and that's why he responded, Jesus. The Bible says he cried, Jesus, thou son of David, have mercy on me. You see, when the blind man referred to Jesus, not as Jesus of Nazareth, but Jesus, son of David, he was speaking of the messianic lineage of Jesus. The Bible says that he would come from the line of David. So my brothers and my sisters, when the blind man said, Jesus, son of David, he was seeing Jesus in his mind, not just as a preacher, not just as a miracle worker, but he was seeing Jesus in his mind as his Messiah, his Savior from sin. And can I just tell you something tonight? You may have some temporal needs. Somebody here tonight might can't find the money to pay the bill. Somebody here tonight might be sick in their body. Somebody here tonight might be having some problems with their children, problems in their relationship. Can I tell you tonight that Jesus, hear me somebody, I said Jesus is more than just bread when you're hungry. It is more than just money in your pocket when you're broke. It is more than just a healer when you're sick. It is more than just a relationship fixer. Jesus is your Savior from sin. The Bible says, his name shall be called Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins. We don't oftentimes think of Jesus as our Savior. We want to think of him oftentimes as the person, as the God who can fix our problems. And so all we want him to be is a Jesus who provides us with a companion when we are lonely. All we want him to be is a Jesus who put money in our pockets when we are broke. But my brothers and my sisters, Jesus didn't leave all the way from glory to come down here just to give you a husband or a wife. Jesus didn't come all the way here just to heal you when you're sick. He came down here to save you from your sins, to save me from my sins. That's the Jesus we serve. And that Jesus, brothers and sisters, is passing by, and he wants us to understand that he's not just passing by just to fix us temporarily, but he's passing by to fix us eternally. Bible says that the blind man cried out, Jesus, son of David, have mercy on me. And understand, my brothers and my sisters, that when the blind man cried out, Jesus, son of David, have mercy on me. You see, we have to understand the context back then, that blindness was seen as as a result of sin. When you read John chapter 9, the Bible says that Jesus was one day walking with his disciples, John chapter 9, verse 1 and 2. And the Bible says they saw a man that was blind from birth. And the disciples asked the question, Master, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind? And Jesus told them, neither was this man or his parents committed a sin, but that the work of God might be manifested. I'm trying to tell you something, that blindness was seen as a result of sin. But I thank God that some problems we have is not because of our sin, but because God wants to use it to his name, honor, and glory. It doesn't mean because you're a follower of God, you won't have problems. You see, sometimes we believe that when we accept Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, that we become immune, that we'll never have another issue in life. Can I tell you something? That's when sometimes all hell breaks loose. I don't want to stop by here tonight and tell you that when you accept Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, everything is going to be smooth and dandy. Can I tell you something? When you accept Jesus Christ, Satan put a bullseye on your forehead. And Satan, his primary purpose, the Bible says he came down here having great wrath because he knows his time is short. Satan's worked overtime to deceive and to cause people to lose their way and to go to hell. And my brothers and my sisters, the good news is that while Satan works overtime, the Bible says that we serve a God who neither sleep nor slumber. He's a God who is always looking out for you and for me. I praise God tonight for the Jesus that we serve. Yes, let Satan do his thing, but we praise God tonight that we serve a God who is always looking out for our best interests. Amen, somebody. Bible says, and he cried saying, Jesus, thou son of David, have mercy on me. I believe the man was saying, mercy, Lord, because I'm broken. Mercy, Lord, because I'm a castaway. Mercy, Lord, because I'm broke and I need some money. Mercy, Lord, because I need your help. Mercy, Lord, because I want to get rid of the stigma that's attached to me, that when people see me, they don't just see me as somebody who may be the result of sin, but I want, Lord, when they see me, they see me as a child of God. Have mercy on me, Lord. The Bible says in verse 39, the Bible says, and they which went before rebuked him that he should hold his peace. But he cried so much the more, thou son of David, have mercy on me. Please notice, my brothers and my sisters, that the Bible says that those who went before, you know who those were? Those were the disciples. Those were the brothers who were closest to Jesus. They told this blind man on the roadside, quit making so much noise. And I'm trying to tell you something, that when you want to live your life for Jesus, when you want to make a decision for Jesus, when you want salvation that Jesus has to offer, there are going to be some people whom the devil will use to try to get in your way to stop you from accepting Jesus. And I'm trying to tell you something, that even people who claim that they are close to Jesus sometimes may become a hindrance to you. The Bible says those who went before, those who were close to Jesus, they told this blind man to quit making so much noise. Sometimes, my brothers and my sisters, when you decide that I'm going to go to the meeting on Friday night, there's going to be somebody telling you, you're going back to church again? I Aren't you tired of going to church? I'm trying to tell you something here tonight, that the devil will try to do anything and everything to stop you from being blessed by Jesus. But I like what the blind man did in the text. The blind man, when he heard them say, quit making so much noise, stop bothering, the Bible says he cried out even louder, Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me. I'm trying to tell you something tonight, that when the devil try to disrupt and to distract you, you have got to have some commitment. You have got to have some stick-to-itiveness that says, I'm not going to let rain or shine or cold or heat or my husband or my brother or my wife or anything stop me from being with Jesus. Satan will cause the car to stop working properly. Satan will make you oversleep and miss church on Friday night. Satan will cause the phone to ring at the inopportune time and somebody talking a lot of foolishness with you on the phone. Satan will do anything to keep you from being with Jesus. But I'm saying to you this evening, my brothers and my sisters, you and I have got to say like this blind man, I'm not going to let anything stop me from being with Jesus. He has been too good. He has been too kind. He has brought me from a mighty long way, and I'm not going to let anybody or anything stop me from being with Jesus. The Bible says, the blind man cried out even louder, much more, thou Son of David, have mercy on me. And the Bible says in verse 40, and Jesus stood and commanded him to be brought unto him. And when he was come near, he asked him, saying, what wilt thou that I shall do unto thee? I'm so glad, my sisters and my brothers, that when Jesus is passing by, and when a sinner who needs a Savior recognize that Jesus is passing by, and we cry out to Jesus for help, Jesus will stop what he's doing just to attend to your cry unto mine. I don't care how busy Jesus is with the rest of the world. When I cried out to Jesus in sincerity, Lord, help me, Jesus will stop what he's doing and come to my help. What a wonderful God we serve. It doesn't matter who you are tonight. It doesn't matter what you're going through. It doesn't matter how difficult it might be. I'm saying to you tonight, cry out like this blind man, Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me. God, I have some habits I need to break. God, I have some friends I need to cut off. God, I need to start attending church more often. God, I need to give my life totally to you. Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me. And my brothers and my sisters, when we cry out to God like that, God of the universe stops and listen to your cry and my cry, because Jesus never turned a deaf ear to the sincere cry of a sinner who is in need of a Savior. The Bible says, Jesus says, what will you have me to do for you? And the blind man said, Lord, that I may receive my sight. I told you before that blindness was associated with sin. So when the blind man said, Lord, that I may receive my sight, what the blind man was saying in essence is, Lord, I don't want to be looked at as a sinner with no hope. I don't want to continue living where people think that I have no chance of making it. Lord, I want to see again. I want to see, Lord. I want to see that the grass is green. I want to see that the sky is blue. I want to see your face, Jesus. Lord, I want to see. I want you to let me see. And my brothers and my sisters, Isn't that the wonderful message tonight? That when you and I cry out to Jesus, whatever our needs are, Jesus, who is able and available to satisfy all needs, can supply your needs and mine. We have the same opportunity this evening as we sit here, as we stand before Jesus, he's asking the same question, my daughter, what do you want me to do for you? Can I tell you something? Salvation is a gift from God. He doesn't force us to be saved, but he's willing to save anyone and every one of us who wants to be saved. And if you and I tonight say, Lord, I want to be saved. I want to walk like Jesus walked. I want to talk like Jesus talked. I want the power to break these bad habits. I want to sing one day and never get tired. I want to shout hallelujah. I want to put on my long white robe one of these days. Lord, I want to be in heaven with you one day. Jesus will grant us our request. My brothers and my sisters, in order for us to be lost this evening, we have to say to Jesus, I don't want what you have to offer. Jesus asked the blind man, what wilt thou have me to do? And the man said, Jesus, I want to see. What is it that you want him to do for you this evening? Can I tell you something? He can pay the bill that you're concerned about. He can heal that disease that you're concerned about. He can fix that relationship that you're concerned about. He can give you that car that you're concerned about. But Jesus doesn't just want to give you temporal blessing. He wants to save you. Ought not just to come to church just for temporal blessings. And we sell ourselves short, my brothers and my sisters, when we come to church and all we are praying for is money. All we are praying for, if I just get a better job, if I just get a bigger apartment or a nicer house, or if I get a better car. God, if you just give me a car. And Jesus is saying, is that all you need? I don't just want to give you a car. That's easy. I don't just want to heal your sickness. That's easy. I really want to save you. And my sisters and my brothers, when Jesus passes by, your response and my response must be, I surrender. I surrender all. All to him I freely give. I surrender all. Jesus came to seek and to save all of us who are lost. And if you come to church week after week, and you come to these meetings night after night, and all you're asking God for are the temporal stuff, stuff that can be here today and gone later, then you're not asking him for anything. I want to encourage you this evening, when Jesus passes by, and he has been passing by this place for years now. He didn't just start passing by when we had these meetings started. He has been passing by this house of worship since the church came into this building that was once a bank. He has been passing by, and men and women have been accepting Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. They have said, Jesus, I want to be saved. And today, by God's grace, they are no longer what they used to be, but they are now a child of God on their way to glory. The Bible says, when Jesus asked, what will thou that I shall do for thee? And the blind man said, Lord, that I might receive my sight. Jesus, the Bible says, said, receive thy sight. Thy faith hath saved thee. What a good God. It tells me, brothers and sisters, that if we have the faith to receive what we're asking for, Jesus can give it unto us. What do you say? The Bible says, Jesus said, receive thy sight. And look what the last verse says. Luke 18, verse 43. And immediately he received his sight and followed him, glorifying God. And all the people, when they saw it, they gave praise unto God. My sisters and my brothers, tonight Jesus wants to give you that which you need the most. Jesus doesn't just want to give you temporal blessings. He wants to save you. And the Bible says, when the blind man received what he was asking Jesus for, the Bible says the man started praising God. I'm trying to tell you something. When God comes by and gives you what you have been praying for, gives you what you have been asking for, you and I ought to show God that we appreciate it by living a life that shows that we are grateful to him for turning our lives around. We can say that the things we used to do, we don't do them no more. The places we used to go, we don't go there no more. The songs we used to sing, we don't sing them no more. The words we used to use, we don't use those words anymore. It's a great change since we have been born. The Bible says not only was the man jumping around and praising God. Can I tell you something? When you receive from God what you have been praying and asking God for, and you begin to praise and worship God, those who see you, those who witness what God has done for you, the Bible says they too will start praising and worshiping God too. Is there somebody here tonight that is causing people who are waiting to worship, waiting to praise God, not to praise God because we have not yet accepted the gift of salvation that he's offering? When you accept Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, can I tell you something? The Bible says, if those here on earth don't celebrate with you, the Bible says, angels rejoice in heaven. All the angels rejoice in heaven over one sinner that repents. There's going to be a celebration. There's going to be a rejoicing. There is going to be a time like we have never had before. We are going to impact the lives of others when we do right, when we accept Jesus Christ, we too, our testimonies will impact the lives of others. My sisters and my brothers, I want you to stand with me tonight. We're going to sing, "Pass Me Not, O Gentle Savior. Hear my humble cry. While on others the word calling, do not pass me by." You see, Jesus passes by. But we can come to church night after night, week after week, and he can pass by where we are sitting and we never had an encounter with him. Tonight you want to say, "Lord, don't pass me by. Stop by my seat, Lord. Have a little talk with me, Jesus. I got a need, Jesus. I've got some habits I need to be broken. I want to do right, Jesus, but I'm struggling to do right. Jesus, do not pass me by." Let's all stand together. Praise him, sing. "Pass me not." One more time from the top. "Pass me not, O gentle Savior."
"Pass me not, O gentle Savior."
Oh, hear my humble cry.
Do
Brothers and my sisters, Jesus is passing by yet again tonight. I'm so glad that that Jesus passes by whenever two or three are gathered together in his name. He's willing to pass by. Tonight we have more than two or three in the house and more than two or three online. Tonight you want to say, Lord, please don't pass me by tonight. I want you to do something special for me tonight. You might be a church member. You might be a visiting friend. You want God to do something special for you. Why don't you raise your hand? If you want God to do something special for you, I don't know your situation. You know what you're going through. You know what your needs are. It could be financial. It could be a medical. It could be just that you want to walk closer to Jesus. After all, I've been saying all night that he wants to give you more than money, more than clothing, more than food, more than a new car. You want a closer walk with Jesus. Why don't you come as we pray? You want a closer walk. You want God to give you the power to live the way he has called you to live. You know your life. You know that sometimes the things you ought to do, that's the things that you're not doing. And the things you ought not to do, that's what you find yourself doing. Can we be honest tonight? We're in church and we don't have to pretend. The truth of the matter is that we are struggling to do what is right. We want God to give us not just temporal blessings. We want to be saved when he comes. That's why we come to church. That's why we sing. That's why we praise God. You have a very special need. For the blind man, he wanted to see. I don't know what your need is. But if you have a special need tonight, just raise your hand. We want to pray for that special need. Jesus is passing by. Do not pass me by. Your heads are bowed, your eyes are closed. Father and God, we give you thanks and praise for passing by here one more time. We thank you, Lord, that when you pass by here tonight, you reminded us that, Lord, you don't just want to give us temporal blessings, but you want to save us. And so, God, we ask you in a very special way this evening to come divinely close unto each and every one of us. God, you know the habits that we're struggling with. You know the areas of our lives that we need to surrender totally to you. God, we don't just want to come to church to appease our consciences. We want to come to church because we want to have an encounter with Jesus. We want to have an intimate encounter with Jesus where we can be saved in your kingdom. So God, I pray tonight for that brother. I pray for that sister. Who is saying to you tonight, Lord, I want to be saved. When all is said and done, I just don't want a nice house. I just don't want a nice car. I just want a nice husband or a nice wife. Lord, my greatest desire is to be saved in your kingdom. God, I pray that you will look down in the deep recesses of our hearts tonight. Whether we came forward or we stayed back in our seats, God, you know our hearts. touch our hearts, we pray, dear God, and help us to surrender our hearts totally to you tonight, we pray. And we pray, dear God, that when it's all said and done, we can declare that we'd rather have Jesus than silver and gold. We'd rather have Jesus than riches untold. I pray, oh God, that you'll help us tonight to leave this place singing that little song, I want Jesus in my heart, in my heart. Lord, I want to be like Jesus in my heart, in my heart. Seal our decisions, we pray, God, for time and for eternity. Bless us and keep us. Bring us back here, we pray, dear God, at the next installment of our series. And I pray, dear God, that we'll also bring a friend, bring a family member with us. And Lord, we pray that when all is said and done, heaven will be your home at last, because we ask it in Jesus' precious name and for his sake. Let the people of God say amen and amen again. You may return to your seats. God bless you.
Amen. We want to say a special amen tonight for Pastor Farron Francis. Amen, everyone. We look forward to seeing you again on Friday night. Friday night at what time? 7 p.m. So you have 5 days to get your family members, get your co-workers, get your neighbors, get your friends. And so at Friday evening at 7 p.m., we are here to continue our service. Our prayer team will now sing our theme song as we lead out. Thank you very much again, everyone, and may God bless you.
I've been changed.